You're listening to Dallas Theological Seminary's Chapel Podcast, a clear voice in chaotic times.
I was just given this week a paper that was written by one of our students. I want to read a paragraph from it. In all this period of grace, God was dealing with men, not as they justly deserved, but in a gracious way, not on their own merits, but because the righteous penalty for sin, which is infinite holiness and justice, demanded were or would be fully met in the person of his own dear Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It must be remembered that grace comes not because of anything that man could or did do, but as a holy, unmerited kindness of God. Grace in all ages has been and still is pure, unwarranted, unmerited grace and favor. We must never permit any departure from this simple definition of grace. Otherwise, it would cease to be any longer grace. That paragraph was written by a 24-year-old in 1939. Dr. Dwight Pentecost thought well as a student, thinks even better as a professor, and has marked all of our lives. And it's a privilege to introduce Dr. P., our professor emeritus in Bible exposition, our resident pastor and theologian in Swiss Tower, and the epitome of one who has modeled the grace of God before us and to us all of these years. Would you join me in welcoming our beloved Dr. P.? I was telling the grade you that. This was a paper that Dr. Pentecost wrote for Dr. Chafer, and he got an 88, but in reality he got a 98 because it was marked 10 points off for being late.
This week has been quite a week in contrasts in the speakers. Monday, one who started to climb up the corporate ladder, step by step until he reached the top rung. Dr. Bailey was our speaker. And today, one who's still struggling to make the bottom rung is on hand. But I'm reminded of the principle that one is elevated to the level of his incompetence. And then Dr. Campbell came, and he spoke from inside the president's office. And I've only been in the president's office to receive a rebuke outside. And then Dr. Bingham came, and you got the long of it, and today the short of it. It's my privilege. You seniors are sending out resumes. Some of you will be quite excited at the response to the resume. And perhaps one will come from a prestigious, well-established church in a large, influential city. You'll be excited. And if you were to examine that church and found that it had all the problems that the Apostle Paul faced as he got a report of the church in Corinth. If you considered a call to that church for even a moment, you're stupid. Here's a church divided by schisms over persons, a church marked by undealt with immorality, a church that is so marked by lawsuits that it is a disgrace before the public. And Paul has to deal with those before he ever gets to the major doctrinal issues that he will spend so much of 1 Corinthians correcting. But Paul had a solution, and I find it in 1 Corinthians 6, in verse 19 and 20. Dealing with the practical issues before he ever gets to the doctrinal issues, he said, "Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit which is in you? Ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God." You are a temple in which God dwells. Now, as background to this, I'd like to take you into the 40th chapter of the book of Exodus. Moses was given careful instructions about the erection, the formation and the erection of the tabernacle. Piece by piece, it was put in place. The articles of furniture were installed. And in verse 33 of Exodus 40, Moses finished the work. "Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation because the cloud abode thereon, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle." Now, it's easy to pass over that statement lightly. But I let my mind wander. And at my age, that's not difficult. In 1 Timothy 6:16, Paul writes that God dwells in light into which no man can enter. We refer to it as the Shekinah, the outshining of the essential glory that belongs to the God of glory. Saul of Tarsus, on his way to Damascus, saw a great light shining from heaven. And such was his brilliance that he was left blinded and had to seek those who could lead him into the city. The brilliance of the outshining of the glory of God. You go into the synoptics, and we read what the three writers have to say about the transformation that took place in the face of and to the clothing of Jesus Christ as he was transfigured, and they exhaust language to try to describe the brilliance of that outshining. And I have to think that the glory that filled the tabernacle was no less than the glory that blinded Saul or that radiated from the person of Jesus Christ at his transfiguration. And while there were linen draperies, and while there were goat's hair coverings, and while there were animal skins that enveloped the tabernacle, it has burst upon me that those were incapable of containing the light within themselves. But that light that emanated from above the mercy seat transfigured and transformed the tabernacle, so that as men approached the tabernacle, they realized that that transformed building was the channel through which God was revealing himself to the nation Israel. He's a God of glory. And in my wandering mind, whether I visualize that by day or by night, I see that edifice as the channel through which God was revealing himself, his nature, his character, to the nation that he had redeemed by blood from bondage. The tabernacle, according to Exodus 25:22, was designed to be a meeting place between God and his redeemed people. And in connection with the erection of the tabernacle, God had made it very clear, I will meet with you there. The tabernacle was not to attract the nation to itself, but became the transformed vehicle through which God revealed himself. And we could wonder why David could write so graphically, so beautifully, so gloriously about the person of his God. And perhaps we can find an answer in Psalm 84, where he writes in verse 10, a day in thy courts is better than 1,000. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. Now, a doorkeeper is not a casual visitor at the door. The doorkeeper positions himself at the door and takes that door as his place of residence. And my suggestion is that David had such a glorious concept of God because he spent time in God's presence. And that which was transfiguring and transforming the physical building was transforming David himself. He was learning of God, and he could pass that on in the songs that he wrote to be sung to the praise and the glory of God. When I turn to the New Testament, I find that Jesus Christ came into this world to reveal the Father, John 1:18. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared or revealed or introduced him. And Christ's ministry up to the point of his death was not to provide a sacrifice for sins, because we were not saved by the life of Christ, but by his words and by his works, Jesus was revealing the Father. And so it's recorded of him in John 1:14, he came and tabernacled among us. So that the physical body of Christ becomes the channel through which the God of all glory revealed himself to those whom he came to save. So that Jesus Christ fulfilled that which the tabernacle was a prototype, a foreshadowing, to reveal the Father. And when Jesus was challenged about his claim to be the Son of God in John chapter 8, verse 28, he said, "My words and my works are a revelation of my Father, because they are not my words, they are the Father's words, and they are not my works, they are the Father's works." And again in John 14, when Philip questioned him, "Show us the Father and it satisfies us," Jesus said, "Have I been so long with you and you haven't seen the Father?" He said, "Everything I did, I didn't do it. It was the Father doing it. The Father was revealing himself through my works. And everything I said, I was not originating it. It was the Father who is in me who is speaking. My words and my works reveal the Father to you." John 17, as our Lord is about to move on to the cross, the world still needs a revelation of the Father because they're in darkness. And taking liberty to paraphrase, Jesus said, "For the same reason you sent me into the world, I now in turn send them into the world." The work of redemption was not to be done by the 12 who would disseminate the message concerning the Son of God. That could only be accomplished by death. But he is setting them apart to carry on the work that he had come, first of all, into the world to do. That is to reveal the Father. "And for the same reason you sent me into the world, I now in turn send them into the world to make the Father known." How would it be done? And as you go through the book of Acts, you find that the 12 are duplicating many of the miracles that Jesus performed. And those miracles were not only to convince the nation that Jesus is the Son of God, but through those very miracles to reveal the nature and the character of his Father. And I'm taking it as in that light that Paul is saying to these Corinthians, God has placed you where you are in order that you might be a tabernacle through which God reveals himself, makes himself known, so that men will not be attracted to the tabernacle, the temple, but will be attracted to the person who's revealing himself through you. What this means is that every believer is essentially a theologian, a revealer of God. John 14. In verse 16, Jesus promised believers would be indwelt by the Holy Spirit. In verses 18 and 20, he promised believers would be indwelt by the Son. In John 14, 23, he promised they would be indwelt by the Father. And the triune God, who set apart the tabernacle to be a channel through which God revealed himself to the people of Israel, has set you apart to be the channel through which he reveals himself, makes himself known, displays his glory. Not that people would be attracted to the tabernacle, but to the God who indwells. This brings us to face a very serious question. Let me address you who are married. If your spouse were asked to write out her concept of God through what he sees in you, of him in you, what would be the nature of her theology? Parents, if your children got their concept of God from what they see you doing and listening to what you say, how far short of what the Scripture reveals about God would their disclosure reveal? Students, if your classmates receive their concept of God and what they hear you saying and see you doing, what would their concept be? See, that's why Peter says that we are living epistles, read and known by all men. It is the desire of God the Father, the Son, and the Spirit so to live through you and speak through you that they use you as God used the tabernacle to reveal his indescribable glory to the nation he redeemed from bondage. Your theologians, how are you living out what the Bible describes as the character of God? Father, you set us apart to be a tabernacle, a temple in which you dwell. And your purpose is not simply to satisfy us, but through us to reveal yourself. Oh God, forbid that we would so veil the glory of God that indwells us, that men see only the external tabernacle and don't see you. You are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God. Let Him work through you. Let Him speak through you. So we become channels of revelation. I pray in Jesus' name.